Today's daf is daf mem, and we'll begin about 12 lines down from the top where we stopped yesterday with the word taima. So you'll see that line begins with bein l'shvius. And the Gemara now goes back to discuss the Mishnah, and the Mishnah speaks about an esrog that has kedusha shvius, and the Mishnah requires that instead of purchasing the esrog, we give it as a gift. And how do you convince the seller to give it as a gift? You beef up the price of the lulav to cover the price of the esrog, and the seller will give the esrog shel shvius as a gift to the buyer. As far as the lulav itself is concerned, it does not have kedusha shvius. And why doesn't it have Kedusha Shvius? So this was the last Gemara that we saw here on the top of Daf Mem. Time of the reason why there's no Kedusha Shvius in Lulav is because the Lulav Bar Shishis, the Chanata of the Lulav took place during the sixth year, and Nichnas L'Shvius. So because the Lulav basically grew or began its process of growing in the sixth year, therefore it doesn't have the sanctity of Kedusha Shvius. The Gemara derives the obvious implication. Ha d'shvius kadosh. Had it been grown during the seventh year, the lulav would have been sanctified with kedusha shvius. If the lulav only would have reached chanota in the seventh year, not in the sixth year, it would have kedusha shvius. So the Gemara samay eitzim bi'almahu. The eitzim ein noig bahen mishum kedusha shvius. We're going to now analyze a brisa from which we're going to derive the conclusion that wood does not have Kedusha Shvius. And the reason for that is going to be because it's not Lachem Li'Ochle. The Torah defines Kedusha Shvius as the mitzvah achila, and we're talking about edibles, but a piece of wood is not edible. And therefore, even had the lulav grown and reach Chanota in the seventh year, it should not have the sanctity of Kedusha Shvius. Why do you assume that the reason why that our lulav and our Mishnah is not sanctified with Kedusha Shvius is because it grew during the sixth year? So Zion, let me grant you that it grew during the seventh year. What difference would it make? It's Eitzim. And Eitzim do not have Kedusha Shvius, the sign we learned in the Braisa. Ale Kanim, Vale Gifanim. If you have the branches of reeds or the branches of vines, shegivavon lechuba al pnei asada. The word shegivavon indicates that you gather together from the field in order to place something into storage. And the reason why it was put in these great silos is because we needed this produce for the winter time. So now we do the lakita and we gather together these vegetables and fruits and grains from the field. That's called givavon, and we place them into storage. We don't need them now during the summer months. We'll need them during the winter months. Now, on occasion, we might need them for the following purposes. Number one, for achilas behema, meaning that even though these branches of wood are certainly not edible, they're not worthy for human consumption, they may be worthy for animal consumption. And number two, we want to gather them together and use them as firewood, as fuel for our campfires and for our ovens. And the Braisa says, what is the status of these ale kanim and ale gifanim? The Braisa establishes that it all depends upon the intention of the person who's collecting them. What is his ultimate goal? Likton l'achila. Now here we have to add a comment. The word achila in the context of Kedusha Shvius means two things, and both are true. It could mean that it's humanly edible, or it could mean that it's animal fodder. And achilas behema is enough to engender kedushas shvius, because that too is called li'achlo. So the word li'achlo, which defines kedushas shvius, is a general term that includes not just achilas adam, but also achilas behem. Therefore, if this particular individual had in mind, when he collected this wood, these stems and branches of the vines, etc., if he had in mind to feed his animal with them, yesh bam kedushas shvius. But if, on the other hand, licked on the etzim, his intention was to use them as fuel, then ein bam kedushas shvius, because then it's not li'achlo, it's not designated for achil. But we see clearly from this braisa that, as a general rule, in and of themselves, etzim, wood, is not omed l'achila, it's not designated for achila. It doesn't have kedusha shvius. The only reason it might be kadosh b'kedusha shvius is because he may have designated it and have an intention to use it for animal food. But a lulav, even if it was grown during the seventh year, it doesn't have kedusha shvius because it's certainly not edible, not for human consumption and not for animal consumption. It's not the same as alei kanim and alei gefanim, which can be used to feed the animals. And if it's omed l'achil, because that was his intention when he did the lakita, when he gathered together, then it would have to do shvius. However, in the case of etzim, let's say, for example, you could have wood that's designated for burning as fuel. That would not have to do shvius. And therefore, if we have to classify lulav, it would seem logical that lulav belongs to the category of liktam lehasakam li'etzim. And liktam li'etzim, if it's not designated for animal food and consumption, then it doesn't have kedusha shvius. So why do you tell me that the lulav in Amisha doesn't have kedusha shvius because it grew during shishas? I'll grant you that it grew during shvius, so it would make no difference. The Amakra, when the Torah defines the mitzvah of shvius at the beginning of Parashas Bahar, and I'll read the entire pasuk, it says, "Vayisa Shabbos ha'aretz lachem li achla l'chol avdecha l'masecha l'schircha l'toshavcha garim imach." And the emphasis here is on the word li achla, and that means that which kinds of growth and vegetation has the sanctity of kedusha shvius, only that which is designated lachem for you li achla. Now, keep in mind, and this is going to be a major issue for us, that the words lachem, number one, and li'achla, number two, which are two contiguous words written in the same pasuk, they have opposite meanings. What do I mean? Lachem indicates any enjoyment, any benefit that you can get. That's always called lachem. Lachem is a word that includes and encompasses all kinds of hadnah. But the word li'achla will reduce and diminish the scope of lachem, indicating that it's li'achla only for achila. Other benefits, like, for example, we mentioned before, hasaka, if you use it to burn as fuel, they would not be included under li'achla, although they would be included on lachem. So at this point, the Braisa says lachem dumya de li'achla. What we're going to have to find is what we call a klal uprat. Klal uprat means that the klal is going to be whittled down and defined by the prat. Lachem, in and of itself, would include the entire broad spectrum of all benefits, of all hanah. But those hanos, by and large, see the exceptions, are fundamentally different than liachila, than eating. However, there are a few designated hanos, pleasures or benefits, that are dumya d'achila. So what the Gemara is going to do now is it's going to define the very essence of achila in terms of representing hana, and it's going to give us the ability to take hana and divide it into two classifications. One classification is lachem hana, which is dumya d'achila, similar to achila, and the other, which is not similar to achila. And the big afkamina is going to be shvius. What would make achila a paradigm of lachem and shed a light on Lachem on Hana, Misha Hana also Ubiuro Shavu, which means immediately when he consumes the food, whether it be fruits, whatever it might be, he immediately enjoys the benefit of it. While he's chewing the fruit, which is called Hana, he's already involved in Biur. Biur means consumption. So the consumption and the benefit are simultaneous. And if that be the case, then when the Torah says, V'hoysa Shabbos ha'aretz lochem li'achlom, it is telling you that the Kedusha Shvi'is applies when you have lochem dumya d'li'achlom, which means any hana where the consumption of the object that gives you benefit and the benefit you derive from it are simultaneous. Yatsu Eitzin Shahana Osam Achar Biuro. But generally speaking, wood, unless it's fit for animal consumption, is designated for hasaka. Hasaka means burning. Now, the benefit you get from burning is subsequent to the burning itself. The consumption of the wood precedes the hana. That's called hana asam li'achar bi'uro. And that doesn't make it similar to li'achla, because li'achla means hanasan ubi'uram shava. Shava means simultaneous. And we'll soon see that, let's say, in a case of light, and you burn oil for light, it could be that the moment that you light the candle and you start consuming the oil, immediately you get the R, the Hana. But in the case of, we'll call it a campfire, you take the wood, you burn the wood, you convert it into coal, then you put your pot or your hot dogs on the fire. The Hana comes after the beer. And in the case of lulav, how do we classify a lulav? So wood in general, which is designated la'asaka for burning, is not included in Kedusha Shvi'is. But where do we put lulav? So here we have a chiddush. What do they do with the lulav? They used it for something that was a little bit more important than just burning it as fuel. And that's called kibud habayis. Now, today we go into a store, we buy a broom. In the old days, what they did was, they took the leaves of a lulav, they bound them, they would bind them together, and that was their broom, le kibud habayis. And the Gemara says, in answer to the question, why does the lulav, if it would have been grown in the seventh year, have Kedusha Shvi'is? The answer is because lulav is considered lachem li'achla. Wow, that's paradoxical. Why is lulav lachem li'achla? If li'achla means that hana asan ubiurim shava, why is lulav classified as hana asan ubiurim shava? So here's the chiddush. Immediately, as soon as he starts sweeping the floor, the lulav loses its original pristine new form. It already is called kilkul. So the first sweep, when you clean out the dust from your house by using this lulav, already begins immediately a process. I mean, the more you sweep, the more the process proceeds and increases. Of kilkul. Kilkul meaning the lulav is getting ruined, it's getting spoiled. It's no longer sturdy, it's no longer strong, it's no longer new, it's full of dust, etc., etc. But believe it or not, this is called hana asan ubiuram chava. It means that the lulav qualifies as lachem li'achla, lachem dumya diliachla. Whereas, if you remember the case that we had earlier today about the stems of reeds and vineyards, there it's omed lachilas behema. There, it is kadosh b'kedusha shvias because it's li'achlo. As soon as the animal consumes these vines and so forth, it consumes and benefits simultaneously. Now we get to the third category, and that's Eitzim La'asaka. There, it's En Hana'asan Ubiram Shok. So with regard to Stam Eitzim, then it could go one way or it could go the other way. If he's going to use the Eitzim to feed his animals, then it's Hana'asan Ubiram Shava. And that's exactly Lachem Li'achlan has Kedusha Shvi'is. If on the other hand, he's going to use it as Hasaka, to keep the fuel going in his oven, then it's ain hana asu birum shava because the hana comes after the birum. That's when the fire goes up and he puts his pot on it. So therefore, in the case of stam eitzim, it all depends on his intention. We don't know what he is intending to designate these eitzim for. But in the case of a lulav, we can assume that the only benefit he gets from a lulav is kibud habayis, and kibud habayis qualifies as hana'asan ubiram shava. So the Gemara asks, va'ika eitzim d'mishchan. What about the branches of what's called atzei shemen? Atzei shemen are used to burn the oily substance in the eitzim, and it creates a kind of a flame, which is called an avuka. And in that case, the Gemara says, it's hana'asan ubiram shavet. He is going to benefit immediately, simultaneously, with the biur, with the consumption of these atzei mitzvah. And therefore, they should be sanctified with kedusha shvias. Why do you tell me that eitzim, when they are designated for burning, are ein hanasan ubiram shavet? That might be true for most eitzim, but it's certainly not true for eitzim d'mishchan. Amar Rava, stam eitzim la'asaka ein omdu. Your general category of eitzim are not like the category of eitzim d'mishchan, and therefore they don't have a chalos kedusha shvius. And therefore, even if he decides that he is going to use these eitzim for a different purpose, that's not the general purpose for which it's used. And my opinion is that we have here a kind of halacha bittul berov. And when we deal with the question of whether eitzim are sanctified with kedusha shvius, we look at the rov. We don't look at the unique case. If you have 50-50 and you don't know which to go, then we'll ask him, what is his intention? But if the majority of the people would use these eitzim in an ofen, in a way that is hana'asa li'achar birim, which means they are devoid of kedusha shvius, then the fact that you have this one exceptional case is not enough.
The lulav is being used dalad meaning. Use the dalad meaning, is that
I think we're going to have to wait for your question because it's going to come up a little bit later on. But in any event, there's something called oily wood whose benefit coincides, they use that word, I call it simultaneous, with its consumption. The wood itself is lit and we have the light immediately as the wood is lit. Amar Rava, wood in general is meant for fueling a fire, not to be used for its light. And in the note, he writes, the types of wood used as firewood were given to man as fuel for fires. Again, he doesn't really explain this halach of Rav, but I think what we're saying is that Rov Eitzim of Asaka, not for R, not for the Ma'ar part. So now the Gemara wants to know the Eitzim La'asaka. You should know that the status of Shvius vis-a-vis Eitzim La'asaka is a matter of debate. Tanoihi, Isanya, we learned in Ebraisa, Ein Mosrim Peiro Shvius. lo lemishra v'lo lekvusa. Rabbi Yossi Omer Moshe. We have here a machlokas between the Tanakam and Rabbi Yossi about taking pairs of shmiyas that are sanctified with kedusha shmiyas and using them as detergents. For example, and again, this may sound a little bit strange to our ears, but what they used to do is they used to actually take laundry and soak it in wine. I'm assuming that the wine, either its color was similar to the color of the garment, or alternatively, the wine was just being used to take out a smell and give a good smell. But in any event, they use these peros shvias, let's say grapes, and they use the wine that was derived from these grapes as a detergent. That's called mishra. They would take linen, what we call flax, and they would soak it in wine. Kvusa is again a kind of detergent. In a general sense, they would use somehow the produce and juices of peros shvias for kibbutz. Now, in both of these cases, the hanah comes li'achar bi'ura. Rashi explains that the hanah you get is only later on when you wear the beged, not when you clean the beged. So the wine gets already ruined, or anything that you use for soaking linen will automatically, immediately begin to be miskalkel, right? It has that bad odor and it picks up all the dirt and so forth and so on. But the hanah that he gets is way down the line. And therefore, we can understand the shita Rav Yossi mostly. Since the hanah comes after the biur, it's not lachem liyach. If that be the case, then we are not violating any sort of prohibition. Let's go over this one more time. According to the Tanakhama, in the case of detergent, the hanos li'achar biur, how would we allow this? Apparently, no. What did I just say? I said, how do we allow this? No, I'm sorry. That's already Rabbi Yossi. Again, Rabbi Yossi is going to say that we can get the shittas. I'm sorry. I apologize. He's just according to Tanakama. It's Hana Osam Li'achar Biur when he wears the beged. And therefore, this would not be a kiyum of kedusha shvi'itz. Why? Because kiyum kedusha shvi'itz requires lachem dumia d'liachla. This is not lachem dumia achla because that note comes later. So in that sense, we understand the Tanakhama. Rabbi Yossi says that I don't hold for this whole business of hana asan that it has to be hana asan b'yurim shav. Let's go through the Gemara. My time at the Tanakhama. From whence does Tanakhama derive the conclusion that it has to be Hada Asan Biron Shava? The Omar Kra, the Torah says, Vaisash Abasa Oretz Lachem Li Achla. And we're going to darsh in the Pasuk Li Achla, meaning that any Hanah that you benefit from Kedusha Shvias, has to be similar to what? The Li Achla to Achila, Velo Lemishra, Velo Lekvusa. Because in these cases, it's not similar to Li'achla, the hanah comes later. So the Gemara now turns it around, my time with Rabbi Yossi. And apparently Rabbi Yossi has some source from which he derives the conclusion that any hanah that you benefit is a kiyum, is a fulfillment of the mitzvah of Shvi'is, even if you're using it as a detergent. From whence does he derive this? Omar Kra Lachem. Let's not emphasize the word li'achla, but rather emphasize the word lachem. Lachem l'chol tzarchecha. Lachem is a generic term including all hanah. Afil l'mishra, b'lichvusa, even if you're using it as a detergent, where the hanah comes after the biur. So we see clearly that in some, we have machlokas tanon between the Tanakhama who darshins the pasuk li'achlo, and therefore he requires that the achila, or shall we say the hanah, has to be similar to the achila, and it's got to be a simultaneity of both the biur and the hanah, whereas Rabbi Yossi darshins the word lachem, and Rabbi Yossi therefore holds that I don't care what kind of benefit you get, and Kedusha Shvius will therefore extend to include this kind of detergent use, even though the Hanoah comes after the Biur, because the emphasis on the word Lachem.
What does he do with the word Lachilah?
Right, that's now the Gemara is going to go through all the Psukim, but I'm just in general, you know, we're lining up the forces here. So the Chachamim put the emphasis on the word Liachla,
yeah,
and Rabbi Yossi on the word Lachem. Now, let's keep in mind that until this point, we said that Stam Eitzim is Lahasaka, and therefore there is no Kedusha Shvi'ith. That can't work out according to Rabbi Yossi. Rabbi Yossi would hold that Stam Eitzim, even if they're Lahasaka, that would be a Kiyum of Kedusha Shvi'ith. So Kedusha Shvi'ith would include Eitzim as well. But we don't need the answer that the lulav is used as a broom, and therefore it's hanasim b'rav shav. So the Gemara asks, "V'tanakama haksiv lachem." What will the Tanakama derive from the word lachem, which implies all tzarchechem, all hanos? Ahu lachem duya d'liachla shanasim b'rav shav yotzam mishra ukvusa shanasim liachar b'ura. And this is more or less a full swing circle to what we said at the beginning of the sugya today, that we need both lachem and liochla, and the tzara shava that equal the common denominator is when you have hanosim v'yirum shava, to the exclusion of detergent, where he's going to wear the garment when it's clean later on. Rabbi Yossi oksiv liochla. What does Rabbi Yossi do with the word liochla if the Torah says lachem, including any hanah that you have? That the Torah defines the kiyum of Kedusha Shvi'is as anything but therapeutic. If you use the fruits or whatever grows during Shvi'is and is sanctified with Shvi'is as a therapeutic refuah, that's not a kiyum of Shvi'is, of Kedusha Shvi'is. And the Gemara later on is going to ask, why do you exclude this and include that? It is sign, like we learned in a brisa, liachla v'lo limlugma. Ata omer liachla v'lo ligmuma o eno ela v'lo likvusa. Who tells you that the word liachla is coming to bump off malugma, medicine? Maybe it's coming to exclude detergents. So the answer is, Kshu Omer Lachem, the Pasuk says, Vaisa Shabbos Aretz Lachem Liachlo, Hare Lekvusa Amo. Lachem means Lechol Tzarchechem, all your benefits, including using it as a detergent. So Hamani Mekayim Liachlo, Liachlo Ligmut V'lo Limlugma, not for medicine. And here I thought the next two words in the Gemara would be my chazis. But instead, it's Mara Isa. Sometimes the Gemara says my chazis. Mara Isa l'rabos es akvusa l'hotzi es ha milugma. Why not on Mem Amidbeis marba ania sakvusa? Oh no, I'm sorry. Did I read? Yeah, that's going to be the answer. Okay, so let's just recap the Gemara's kasha now. You have a miut and a reboot. Liachla is a miut, and lachem is a ribu. And in the final analysis, this brisa reflecting the shita Rabbi Yossi is going to say that the ribu of lachem is coming to include lekvusa, and the miut of liachla is coming to exclude malugma. So now the Gemara says, "My Raisa, why do you juggle it in that? Why not juggle it the other way around? And then we would exclude